Today, if it's anything that we're going to speak. First of all, I want to start by wishing כתיבה וחתימה טובה לשנה טובה ומתוקה. I said many times, and I believe that that one is coming from the Lubavitch Rebbe, that the reason that our holidays is the only holidays that we're blessing each other with כתיבה וחתימה טובה לשנה טובה ומתוקה 1 month before is the reason behind. What is the reason? The reason is very simple. You know why we're blessing each other 1 month before? Because the one that blessing is always the one that being blessed. Moshe, when a Kohen is going in and blessing the Jews, who is blessing the Kohen? When I was a little child, I was always bothered. I said to my father, Rahmat Kunam, thank God I'm not a Kohen. He said, why? He said, who bless them? I mean, he's a loser, he's blessing us, but who bless them? My father said, you see it all wrong. Who bless him is the Almighty God. The reason that we're blessing each other for 1 month, כתיבה וחתימה טובה, לשנה טובה ומתוקה, is because when you're blessing someone else, God bless you. So the Shulchan Aruch write from the beginning of Chodesh Elul, it's good to write each other in a letter, in WhatsApp, in an email, in any way that you're speaking, to always start by wishing, may God will sign and seal you to the greatest years of your life. Why? This is one of the shortcuts. This is one of the greatest advice that you can have in order to be blessed by Hashem every day. Every day in Chodesh Elul, we're going to be blessed to have the greatest years in our life. This is one advice that I can share. Second advice is what some of you decide and some of you are already doing, is to be ish she'arabim tzrichim lo. אין אמונה ואין אמונה ואין אמונה ואין עוול. צדיק וישר הוא. The Almighty God is different from other people. When you're going into a judge, when you're going into a regular court and a judge judges you because you stole, because you did something bad, the judge doesn't really care how many people will suffer because of the judgment. He doesn't really care what is the cost of the judgment, meaning, if by sending you to a jail for 7 years, the wife will be widow for 7 years, the children will grow up to crying because they have no father, the judge doesn't care. He have to do the judgment. He's ruining your life, and he's ruining your children and your wife's life. Economy-wise, health-wise, and especially spirituality-wise. But he doesn't care. I never saw, it's very rare to see someone that went into the jail and become a good man. Just opposite. Criminal become much wiser after. Because, you know, there was a book by the name De Moach. Yitzhak Drori, one of the strongest thief in the land of Israel. He was maybe in the 70s or late 70s that he made the biggest hit in Europe. He stole, if I remember, 40 million shekel in that time. It was almost like $15 million, or maybe $20 million in that time. He stole it from the bank, and he was not even there. He was at home, watching whatever he was, you know, with his wife and children, watching cartoons. And he made and planned the biggest hit in that time in Europe. When the police catch him, he decides to make teshuvah. And he wrote a book, the book that called The Moach, The Brain. Beautiful books to read, because over there he's writing how exactly it changed his life. And he said, you know why I got to become such a great criminal? I used to steal from people. Money from people. They catch me, they put me to the jail. When I went into the jail, I met some friends, very wise men, and they realized that I'm very smart. So you know what they did? They convinced me to stop stealing people. Let's start to steal stores. So I start to steal store. After they catch me once again, Sofer Ganav Letlia, they put me in a more severe jail. When I went to the heavy jail, they told me, are you joking, you're stealing stores? Let's steal banks. And this is what we did for so long. We used to steal. And each one of them is because the good friends, the good mishpocha that I have, in the jail. The judge doesn't care what's happened in your life, what's happened to your wife's life, what's happened to the children's life. But the Almighty God is different. He's the only judge that in every decision that he's doing, if you give him charity and because of you, the whole yeshiva, or Moshe, our whole kollel is holding because of you. Now what's going to happen if, God forbid, the business is going to go tough? Kollel is going to shut down. Even if you're worldly or not, what is the fault of the kollel that you are worldly or not? So you're going to pass through because of the kollel. Because God will never give somebody else to suffer if it's not deserved. You hear that? If your wife have to suffer because of you, what is your wife's fault? That you are chantaresh. Make the shuvah. And any decision that Hashem is doing, this is one of the best ways, Nadir, to be ish she'atzibur tzrichim lo, to be a public human being. Maybe this is one of the reasons that so many people want to be a rabbi. Not because of the kavod, definitely not because of the salary. Mainly because a rabbi is protected. Why a rabbi is protected? If he's going to suffer, the tzibur need him. You become sealed. Even if you're not righteous, even you're not in the level that you need to be, what is the fault of the tzibur? To lose. Why they have to lose? To be ish she'atzibur tzrichim lo. A human being that the public needs. Gentlemen, ladies, I want to talk to you today about a new topic, a new approach of the way of Teshuvah. Most likely you never heard it. I heard some of the word and I will start. Come, Rabbi Buni Mefashischa, and explain. Listen to his explanation, what is all Teshuvah? We said in Selichot, after Yom Kippur, what did we say? Selachlanu, right, Yom Kippur Tefillah, Tzet Yom Kippur, when we end in Yom Kippur, what did we say in 18? Selachlanu avinu kichatanu, mecholanu malkenu kipashanu. Rabbi Buni Mefashischa asked, what exactly sin you did? You just came out after 30 days, Chodesh Elul. Rosh Hashanah, Aseret Yemei Teshuvah, and Yom Kippurim. Why are you saying, I understand the whole year round when you have to say Selach Lanu. I understand. At night and in the morning, I understand. But you just went out from Yom Kippurim. Netanel, what a beautiful question is that. What kind of sin exactly we did? So last year, I believe that I shared with you one view. Today we're going to add another one. What did I say last series? You know, once there was a chassid that came into a rebbe, and he said, Rebbe, I have a problem. The rebbe said, what's the problem? He said, for 40 days, I fast for 40 days, from morning till evening. And they told me that if you're going to fast 40 days, you're going to see Eliyahu Navi. And I never saw Eliyahu. By the way, one time in the yeshiva, when I was 13 years old, when I was 12, I used to finish on a daily basis the whole Tehillim. I used to go to the Shiurim of Chacham Ovadia. I was very makpid to go to the classes of Chacham Ovadia, Tzion Abba Shaul, in a second I'm going to remember. I used to go to the Shiurim, and I was so into, I used to read Sipurei Tzadikim. So one time I saw in the Sipur, one of the books that I had, that if you don't sleep for 40 days, and you learn in Torah, and you don't spend a minute, you're going to see Eliyahu Navi. Why? I told my chavruta, let's do it. I want to see Eliyahu, that's it, enough. Why we have to wait until we are 60? I want to see Eliyahu Navi. And you know what? For 40 nights, Chizki, we didn't sleep the whole night. We study. Night 40, we got into the night 40. You don't understand, it's like a marathon. When you get into the end, you cannot fall down at the end. And the night 40, it was a noise in that floor. We went into the Zal, to the Bet Midrash. We studied the whole night, and suddenly the door was open and closing. You know what we did? We ran away. We got so frightened. I said, oh, Allah, what's going to happen if this is a different angel? We started to discuss. We ran. So this guy is coming into the Rebbe. He said, Rebbe, for 40 days I fast. How come I didn't see Eliyahu Navi? Listen to the answer of the Rebbe. The answer of the Rebbe is, he took him out. And he showed him the horse. Next. And he said, my dear son, the horse also the whole day is walking. And he eat only at night. And he also doesn't see the owner. Why? Because he is a horse. In order to see an Eonavi, you know, you cannot stay a horse. In a different word. People after 40 days of getting Teshuvah, especially in Shat Ne'ilah, you get in to be angel. And what do you do in Arvit? What exactly passing in your mind? Where is the food? Where is the, this one? All what you have in Arvit is, when exactly we finish? Why the rabbi is speaking 2 minutes too late? Why the chazan is mitchazen? Where is that kiyah b'shofar midakdikim? And then we're running into the food. I don't understand. After you become an angel, how can you become from becoming an angel to become a horse in one split of a second? You just left Yom Kippur. 40 days you build to such a level of Kedushah. Maybe to remind you that you still need to work on yourself. Huh? You know, many rabbanim, you know what they do in Motzei Yom Kippur? Right away, when everybody is going to eat, they take a book and they start to study. And why? Because in this moment, nobody study. You have 1 hour that nobody sees book. They see only food, like they never eat. They never eat for 24 years, not 24 hours. And you know, the schut that you're going to study when the whole America don't study, meaning that the whole America is standing in your shoulder. You know how many zichuyot you're getting in that second? One of the privileges to study Torah at night is because everybody's sleeping. Most of the people are sleeping. So you get the zichuyot of everybody else. You know what it means to study in the end of Yom Kippur? Wow, what a zichuyot. The whole world is busy. Selach lanu avinu. We ask you mechila. Because 1 hour ago we thought that we are angel. 1 hour ago we thought that we are Eliyahu Navi. We thought that we are in the great level. This is one approach. But tonight, I'm going to share with you Hasidut approach. That one is deep and beautiful. Hasidut approach is, you know why we do Selach Lanu? Not because, Chas v'Shalom, you're animals. Because after 40 days that you wake up for Selichot, and you came to Rosh Hashanah, and you came to Yom Kippurim, and you still, in the end, don't believe that Hashem forgive you. Deep down, you don't believe that you can change. You know, I'm with the same habit, the same human being. I'm still a low life. And for that, you have to make selicha. You have to feel bad if you're thinking that Hashem doesn't forgive you and that you cannot change. The pasuk said, Yaazov Rasha Darko. Ve'ish aven machshavotav, v'yashuv el Hashem. Yaazov Rasha Darko, meaning a Rasha, a sinner, have to go away from his foot. Which foot? Which path? A sinner have a path? Which path you have to leave? Rabbi Buni Mefushizcha is asking, which path? Ladies and gentlemen, you know which path? The path that he's thinking that he cannot change. What making people to fall down again and again and again is the lack of faith in themselves that they can change, that Hashem Yitbarach forgive them, that they can get higher and higher and higher. The message of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippurim is that in 1 second, in 1 minute, a person can change from becoming a regular person to become the greatest person in his life. Rabotai, when we're looking at Yom Adin, we see Yom Adin to be like a negative day. You know, some people, if you can ask them, which days is the worst days of the year, they will tell you Yom Kippur about it. Because it's a fighting days. And Be'emet, Chizkiyahu, Yom Kippur is a fighting days. Listen, we have the tefillah among Ashkenazim, and listen to what the tefillah, the word of the tefillah.
היום בראת עולם, היום בראת עולם הוא יישא את עוד אבס. בדעה בנת התפילה דת כל נתנה תוקף. And the word of the תפילה נתנה תוקף is... is fried the word. Days, a day of judgment, a day that the Almighty God decide, and Rosh Hashanah will mention it. V'chol ba'e olam yavu nefanecha. Mi yichye u mi yamut. Mi bekitzo u mi lo bekitzo. Mi b'cherev u mi b'chaya. Mi yahum u mi yishafer. Mi yashir u mi yani. All these questions. V'ata hu. מלך אל חי וקיים. Ladies and gentlemen, our issue in the high holidays is this way. We come into the high holidays so frightened, frightened from Yom Adin, frightened from Borei Olam, frightened from that day. And I will tell you that some of us is going too far and maybe they are wrong and I will explain why. Michael, when you're going into a judge, why are we so frightened? Because we know that the judge doesn't know anything about us. He doesn't care, and he doesn't know the root and the reason behind our sin. But just imagine, if you know that the judge that you go in know everything, the place that you came from, the reason that you made the sin, the limitation that you have in life, your families, the school that you went, he know everything that you in. Can you imagine that a person before he judge you know the whole pictures inside out, what you have in mind? And how many times the tunnel was so frightened to do something? They call it in English cold feet. And it can be even undermined. You know, many people didn't succeed to move on in life because undermined, they decide that they cannot do it. Imagine yourself if this judge know everything in your life. And that judge, by the way, is a person that loves you so much, admire you, care for you. This is what God is all about. A judge, when he takes your judgment, Shai is seeing the whole pictures.
All the reason behind and after. And he judge you according to that. And not only according to that. He judges you because he loves you. He cares for you. And he believes in you. That judge believes that you can change, that you can make different in your life. Rabotai, Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur is not only a day of depression, Chas v'Shalom. It's a day of hope. It's a day that given us hope to believe that Hashem Yitbarach believes in us. You remember the story with Reish Lakish and Rabbi Yochanan? Reish Lakish was walking in, and he saw a beautiful woman in the river. The Gemara said, Baba Metzia, and he was jumping all the way until he fell down and he recognized that this is a man, Rabbi Yochanan, one of the greatest rabbis in that time. And the rabbi looked at him, and you know what, Rabbi, you know what I'm going to say? You know what the Gemara said? You know what the Mefarshim write? You know why he jumped? He didn't jump only because he saw a beautiful woman. He jumped because he wanted to do something, a huge avera with this woman, and some said that he knew that this is a guy. And he jumped, lo alenu v'lo lechem, to do a huge avera with him. You know what we're going to do to such a person? Rasha! Gehenam! You're going to be born! You have no hope! No future! What Rabbi Yochanan said? Yeshar chelach l'oraita. With so much power that you have, I can see the potential in you. And with so much potential, you can become greater. You can become the greatest Talmid Chacham. You know what Reish Lakish said? If such a human being, if such a rabbi believe in me, so most likely he sees something that until now I never saw. Because until now, every place I went, every rabbi I bump into, They always remind me how rash I am. What a sinner. Reish Lakish was a mafia guy. He was not a nice guy so much. Most likely many people disappeared. When they took him into the jury, most likely he was always going out not guilty, you know why? Because the jury disappeared, one by one, until there was no jury. And sometimes the judge also disappeared. The whole community disappeared. He was a mafia person. He used to steal, he used to rob. And no, no, even maybe to kill. And from such a human being, from such a man, Moshe just believed in. Hashem Yitbarach believed in us. Hayom Arat Olam. You know what you mean, Hayom Arat Olam? Arat meaning pregnancy. Hirayun. This is one explanation of the word Hayom Harat. But there's another pirush. You know what you mean, Hayom Arat? Hayom Nolad Aolam. The world is being created. The world is being created. Meaning, every one of us passing in Rosh Hashanah these questions. What do you want? You want to still remain in pregnancy? Or you want to go out and to recreate yourself again? Many of us here in this room remain in pregnancy for so many years. Many of us remain with our limitation because we don't believe in ourselves. We don't believe that we can do it. You know what you remind me? You remind me two animals. Listen to the animals that I'm going to tell you. You're not going to believe. I saw it in Thailand. When I went into Hong Kong, I was a rabbi in Hong Kong. The last month, I took my wife to Bet Chabad in Thailand just to see the Chabad house. And you know, we went into a trip. And I saw an elephant, huge elephant, with many children, and you take a ride on an elephant. And I'm talking about huge. And you know what hold the elephant? Robes. Simple robes. Nothing. The robes, and I'm talking about huge, I mean, not huge. Magnificent, not magnificent. Monster! The elephant is like that. He looks at you. You just see him and... Oh la la, this is something scary. Ayom, arat olam. Mila chayim, umila ma. And then he reminds you, tshuva utfila utzdaka. And then you're asking the guy, how come the elephant doesn't realize, in order not to be slave, to break the ropes and to run, and that's it. Moshe, another second. I want you to hear it. You came all the way from Main Street. He's worthy. Chizki, listen to that. You know why? I asked the guy over there. And you know what the guy explained to me? Listen to the explanation. Because when the elephant was a little child, they put him in this robe. And when he was a child, he tried to run. But in that time, the robe was so strong, and he was 2 weeks. So he tried for a few months, for 1 year, for 2 years. After 2 years, that's it. He realized that he would never be able to break. 20 years later, he doesn't even try because deep down he believes that he would never be able to break it. Rabotai, the second animal is a fly. Did you ever put a fly, big flies, in a box? Put it in a box, you know, you put it in a box. No, fly, they're not so smart like human beings. How do you know that? Because inside of the box, what are they doing? They try to run from the box. So what they do, they're going back, and they get hit, boom, and back. They're going in, boom, back, boom, back, boom, back. And after maybe 1,000 or 3,000 times, boom, back, you know what they're doing? They're flying until 10 inches. How much is it? The back's 10 inches. Until 10 inches only. Because they realize that above 10 inches, they will get the heat from the box. From the cover. Moshe, you know what's funny? Even if you're going to take the covers, after that, they will not go above 10 inches. You know why? Because they put themselves in limitation. Ladies and gentlemen, Hayom Arat Olam Minin! Do you want to remain in pregnancy? Or you want to go away and to decide, I can do it. I can make change in my life. I can recreate. The same way that God created the world in Rosh Hashanah, the same way I'm going to create myself. And nothing we limited myself. The shofar is reminding to all of us, don't fall down to this attitude. No, this is me. I cannot do it. Because 10 years ago they told me I will never be successful. Because I tried the business and I didn't succeed one time and that's it. Don't become like the elephant and the fly. You can change in anything that you do in life, spirituality and physically. You can be successful in anything. Rabotai was a child, a very famous one. His name is Anatziv Mevolozhin. Anatziv Mevolozhin came out one time when he was a little older, and he asked the student, he shared with the student the story, how come he became the Netziv? What exactly made him to become such a great rabbi? Listen to that, the rabbi was a little honest, very honest. Why? He told the student, dear student, when I was 13 years old, Moshe, I never opened a book. I was the worst child in the school. I mean, I passed an age of 13, already 7 yeshivot. 7 yeshivot. And any yeshiva that the Netziv Mevolozhin is one of the Gedolei Israel. And any yeshiva that they accept me, they told me right away 1 or 2 days later. You know what made me to make a change? Beautiful story. He said, I was sitting down in my bedroom one night. And you know, I hear my father and my mother speaking in the living room. And you know what I did? Like a very other child, I went in, opened the door a little, and I was listening. And I heard my father telling my mother, enough is enough, that's it. Our son doesn't build to be in yeshiva anymore. It's not for him. You know, not everybody, God bless him, to be a Rosh Yeshiva or to be successful, not everybody. This is not his potential. Tomorrow I'm going to take him to be a carpenter. How do you call it, carpenter? Carpenter, right? To build maybe a shelf for the books for the yeshivot, standard, to build teva. To do great things for others, but this is his job. This is his mission in life. When I heard it, my heart was broken. And I see my wife, my mother fighting for me, and my father said no. After 7 yeshivot, 13 years old, not even one day that he cared for study. He never opened the Gemara when he came into the school. Enough is enough. In the morning when I wake up, I didn't sleep the whole night. When I wake up, it's 5 o'clock. I saw my father waking and preparing to take me. I told him, Abba, I have to be honest with you. I heard it. I heard the conversation that you have last night with Ima. And I'm asking from you, last chance. Give me the last chance. If today I'm not good, take me any place. You want me to be a shoemaker? I'm going to be a shoemaker. I have no problem. But one day. Give me one day. And I was crying. And the father says, you know what, my son? I'm giving you last chance, last day. From that last day, I become one of the greatest rabbis in this generation. Now, gentlemen, I will ask you this way. And he continued, and he said, what do you think that I came in to such a decision at such a young age? Because I ask myself, after 120 years, they're going to ask me, and it's an evolution, what exactly you did? And I said, you know what I did? I did standard, and I did bookshelf, and I did Aron HaKodesh, and I did Bimot. I did many great things, but they're going to ask me, yes. But what about Ha'emek Davar? His commentary that he wrote about all the Torah. He have a commentary in all the Torah, in all the Chumash, a beautiful commentary. What about Imre Shefer, a commentary that he have in the Haggadah? He have many other books. What about these books? Where is these books went away? After 120 years, they will ask each one of us, where is your potential? In Rosh Hashanah is a night, is a day. Chodesh Elul in Yom Kippurim is a time for us to reveal our potential. reveal and to understand that with our power, with our brain, I share that with my class. I share this story in my class today in the morning. I will listen to this one. It was this camel, you know, a camel, a gamal, a camel, an animal that's called
camel.
A camel.
Yeah, yeah.
This camel came in to his own mother and he said, "Ima, Ima, why do we have a hump? Hump is the, right? Why do we have a hump? What ugly things is that? Why do we need it? This nonsense. I mean, you know, all the animals, they are normal. Why do we need a hump?" So the mother told him, "My dear son, not only that is not ugly, this is what saved our life. We are animals that are supposed to go into the desert. And that hump given us enough to sustain 40 days in the desert with no water and with no food. We stuck everything in the hump, it's like a storage that we're using it for so many weeks after. My dear son, this hump is the greatest thing that you can have." So the son continued, said, "Ima, okay, I got the hump. But why do we have eyelashes so big? You know, the eyelashes of camels, they are unusual. Such eyelashes, you see only eyelashes. You don't see eyes." He said, "Ima, it's so ugly. Imagine yourself if we had to put these eyelashes, you know, the things that the ladies put. Mascara, how do you call it?
Mascara.
Mascara. Imagine yourself, it's going to take him 2 hours, only one eyes." He said, "Ima, why do we need it?" She said, "My dear son, not only that it's not ugly, this is the greatest gift that God gave us. And you know why it's such a great gift? Because when we're going to go in the desert, sometime a wind is going to come and the sand is going to go to our eyes. In order to protect the eyes, God creates." The guy said, "Amazing. But Ima, last questions. Why do we have such a long foot? The foot of a camel, his own leg, his own foot is so huge, long." He said, "What is it so long? I tried to find the shoes, I never succeed. No shoes create so long. We cannot have a little sensitive, small shoe, small leg. And the mother said, "My dear son, once again you're wrong. You know why we have? Because when we're walking in the desert, sometimes we have bitza. How do you call bitza in English?
Swamp.
I said, a swamp. Not for no reason. We have swamp. And in order not to fall down to this swamp, God created such a long way to save ourselves." The child said, "Ima, I'm sorry that I'm adding, but the last questions. And this is the last question I'm going to ask you. So, Ima, if we had such a long leg in order to be saved from the swamp, if we had such a big eyelashes in order to be safe from the wind and the dust, if we have such a hump in order to have 40 days food, so why are you and me still stuck in the zoo? So what are we doing in the zoo? Gentlemen, ladies, each one of us in Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur will ask himself, each one of us in Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur will ask himself, if God gave us so much potential, if God gave us so much brain, so much heart, so much knowledge, if God gave us the ability to see, to walk, to speak, to change the world, so what are we doing in the zoo? Why are we still stuck in our own zoo? Ayom Arat Olam. The day that can give you from being pregnancy to be delivered, to go away from your own limitation, from the place that you're stuck in, the womb of your mother, and to go out and to create a world. Yair is Rosh Hashanah. Shachar and Rosh Hashanah is a time that you can break any limitation and anything that fights you in mind and under mind, and you can achieve the greatest opportunity, the greatest achievement, the greatest goals that you want in life. A person in one day can become a righteous man, in one day A person can change his life in 1 second. Rabbi, this is my habit. This is what I got used to. I cannot stop being angry. I cannot control my jealousy. I cannot control my eyes. I cannot... Because of that, we have the Yamim Noraim. Yamim Noraim is not only frightened. Yamim Noraim is the day of revealed. According to Hasidut, in that day, God revealed himself. How that Rish Lakish said, if he believe in me, most likely I have something to believe on. If God believe in each one of us, that we can do it, that we can change our life, that we can transfer our life to much greater, no doubt that God know, God gave us the greatest gift, the gift in our life. Hopefully we're going to achieve that message to our own life. And this year, and this Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, we're going to take our vision, and we're not going to live anymore in a pregnancy level. We're not going to be... And this is, by the way, this is what the Kohen is asking in Yom Kippur. One of the three favors, one of the three requests that the Kohen is asking is what? Velo tapil isha rechma. May a woman will never have miscarriage. Until now we understand when a woman will never have, we're talking about woman and miscarriage. But according to our speech, and I heard Rabbi Jacobson explained it beautifully. You know what it means when a woman will not have miscarriage? May our dreams and our petition will not fall down to be miscarriage. May we gonna achieve everything that we came here to achieve. K'tivah v'chatimah tova. L'shana tova u'metukah.